Welcome, and thank you for joining the webinar today. I'm Amanda Jadro, the Director of Portfolio Management at TRESCOM. As an administrative and financial solutions provider to the staffing and consulting industry, it is our philosophy to be an active member by staying abreast of the ever-changing marketplace. For that reason, TRESCOM was pleased to launch the Industry Insider webinar series designed to share our expert knowledge and resources with our fellow staffing industry colleagues. One of our core values is to build relationships and become a leading resource to staffing and consulting firms nationwide. Our presenters today are Trent Hyatt and Amanda Brock with Staff ACA. As a full-service ACA reporting solution, Staff ACA removes the questions, compliance issues, and the headaches for staffing professionals looking for a proven partner to fulfill their 1095 reporting. By aligning themselves with payroll, with experts in the payroll and administrative services like TRESCOM, they are able to deliver excellent solutions to businesses not well equipped to generate, distribute, and electronically file the ACA forms. As their name implies, they specialize in ACA reporting and tracking for the staffing industry. Trent is the co-founder of Staff ACA and leads the company as the head of marketing. By placing tremendous emphasis on partner relationships, his efforts have led to a significant growth of Staff ACA, including multiple national partnerships. Trent is known for his quick wit, good-hearted demeanor, and old-fashioned work ethic. He never backs down from a challenge. He resides in low country of South Carolina with his wife and two boys and enjoys fishing, hunting, and family time. Amanda is well-versed in ACA compliance and employer reporting. With years of experience since the law's inception in 2014, she brings a plethora of practical reporting knowledge to the staffing industry. In leading the team at Staff ACA, she manages workflow process from client onboarding to data integrity to IRS filing validation. Perhaps her favorite company initiative has been pioneering a customer appreciation model that features on-site delivery of treats and sweets to clients around the country. Amanda is a lifelong resident of upstate of South Carolina and loves spending time outdoors with her family and friends. In today's January Industry Insider webinar, we'll provide an in-depth discussion on ACA reporting, including employer compliance on Form 1094-C and Form 1095-C as it relates specifically to the staffing industry. During the session, Staff ACA will address key areas including full-time status, self-funded plan requirements, 91st day rule, and penalties in 2020. By the end of this session, you'll know how to ensure compliance for ACA reporting. With that, I will turn the floor over to Trent and Amanda.
Okay, thank you very much for that introduction. That was very kind of you. So I am Trent Hyatt, and I will be conducting this alongside of Amanda Brock, and I'm going to be very straightforward and upfront. I will cover this information, but this information it can be a little bland. It can be a little bit boring. This is compliant, and so I will try to make it as interesting as I possibly can. And I will try to not be so long-winded. I tend to talk a little bit too much, I'm told. So what I'll do is I will jump right into this presentation, and I may turn a couple of things over to Amanda Brock, who's the real brains of this. So let me just continue on. So this first slide is saying, hey, look, we do ACA reporting for the staffing industry. We started doing this in 2015. And we have been doing this since. So we are literally in our, what is it, sixth year? This is our sixth year. And so can everyone hear me, by the way? I'm not sure if any people can hear me properly.
Trent, I can hear you.
Can you hear me? Okay,
yeah.
Just making sure. I'm sorry. My phone started flashing, and I've done these things before where I've talked for 10 minutes and no one heard me, so I apologize. All right. So So getting into the information, Staff ACA was created specifically for the needs of the staffing industry. What we did was we started a company called Sky Insurance Technologies because we were looking at the Affordable Care Act legislation, and we saw that the employer mandate, also known as 6056, was going to really take effect in 2015. And ALEs, also known as applicable large employers, were going to have to begin reporting their benefits offerings as well as payroll information for each of their employees starting in 2015, and they were having to do it for every single month of the calendar year. This information is reported on 1094 and 1095C, and it helps carry out some of the regulations that were written under 6056, which is the employer mandate under the Affordable Care Act. Very early on, we were able to figure out that certain issues arose within the staffing industry because they had a non-traditional workforce. So determining hire dates and termination dates for staffing companies usually was a point of difficulty for them. And so we decided to create the brand Staff ACA to cater specifically to the needs of the staffing industry. So what is it that we do? What we do is we offer a full service form 1094, 1095 form creation. The 1095C is predominantly what we do, but we do 1095Bs as well. And of course, the transmittals are the 1094s that go along with each of those. So what we like to do is we try to say, hey, look, you have a lot on your plate. This compliance, this reporting is very complex, and it's a headache for many people, but especially people in the staffing industry. So what we tried to do and what we succeeded at doing was creating a service, not just a software, but a service. To me, the difference is that we have people that will walk you through our software to help say, this is what is expected, this is what has to be done, this is who's going to do it, and this is when it's going to be done by. And so literally from onboarding, people from our staff are available to walk you through this entire process because we have done this. By now, we've done this thousands and thousands of times. And so the idea is that we gather basic information about your company up front, we fill out health plan information, and then we upload documents that contain payroll information, time and attendance, but also benefits offerings as well, such as who was offered MEC coverage, was anyone offered a minimum value coverage, when were they in a limited non-assessment period, and in addition to those things, we also can determine who is full-time and who is part-time with regard to the ACA. So a lot of people have different opinions about this is how we determine full-time status or part-time status, or hey, this person is hired or terminated. But the ACA has very specific rules on how to determine this, and a lot of staffing companies have issues when it comes to these, because to me it was very obvious that when this legislation was written, staffing companies were not taken very heavily into consideration. So what we're able to do is we're able to take your data, we're able to format it for you, and we upload it into our software. What we then do with that data is we create forms 1094, which is a transmittal document, and we create forms 1095. 1095 is also transmitted to the IRS on the employer's behalf, but each individual within the company must also be furnished a Form 1095C, and typically that's by January 31st following the actual reporting year. So for 2020, those forms must be furnished to employees by, well, I think we have about three more days here, unless there are extensions, and each year we don't count on getting extensions, but we end up getting them, and so, but we always plan on not getting those extensions. So if you're looking at the dates without extensions, January 31st is the standard date for furnishing the forms to employees, and then March 31st is the deadline for e-filing, assuming they do not extend the March 31st deadline, which they actually haven't in previous years, but they did at first. So what we do is we like to say that we offer every service that you need, soup to nuts, start to finish. So from initial client onboarding all the way through printing and mailing these forms to employees' houses, to checking for accuracy on the forms, to coding the forms for you based on the data that we receive, all the way through to finally e-filing on your behalf, And then we can also help with IRS audit and inquiry assistance in the event that you are audited, or even if you've had a previous year filing where the IRS comes back and says, hey, the data that you submitted to us was either incomplete or maybe inaccurate. And some people come to us with actual penalties from previous year reporting errors that we did not do, but maybe they did it themselves or used a different vendor. And we can help communicate on your behalf to the IRS to help get those situations straightened out. Everything we do, obviously, we're handling PHI, protected health information. Everything we do is HIPAA and HITECH compliant. And again, I think one of the points that I want to highlight is we do full data processing. So with a lot of services that we have seen, you end up having to format your data into a format that the software likes. All right, so you have a ACA reporting vendor, and that vendor requires you to manipulate software that comes out of your payroll system or your benefits enrollment systems or HRIS or whatever. You end up having to take it in the format that it's in and then reformat it for every month for every employee into the format that the actual vendor software will accept. For us, we say, let us do that for you. If you can get us the data, we will format it for you in an effort to make your life easier. So here's our process. I've already kind of outlined this a little bit, so I won't tarry around on this too much. So step one, we do customer onboarding. This is actually after we sign a business associate agreement, which makes it okay for us to share data. We'll actually sign a service agreement as well. But after that is done, we'll do customer onboarding. We will gather the company data. There's a number of data fields that we ask for. We can give you a prep sheet prior to our initial call to say, this is the data that we're looking for. Here's where most of our clients can find that data. And then if you're not able to gather all the data, sometimes we'll even do a joint call to help you get the data. So what happens after that is after we have gathered the company data, we will format that data and we will actually create those forms. And so within our system, you are able to see digital versions of the 1094 and 1095C forms. The 1094 would just be a transmittal form on behalf of the employer, but each individual employee would have a 1095 form. You're able to see those in our system, download them in PDF format to check for accuracy before you finalize. And so if need be, you can make several versions of those forms. Sometimes we have clients that submit data, but they do it in pieces. And so what happens is they create several versions of the forms, or maybe they come back and say, hey, you know, we created the first version of forms with this data and it wasn't complete, so let's update it. And we're able to do all of that within our system before we actually finalize the forms. Once we finalize the forms, that's what we call approving for distribution. Those forms can be downloaded in PDF format for the employer to distribute themselves, or if you would like, we can actually print and mail those first class priority mail out of a print facility that we partner here, we partner with here in Greenville, South Carolina. So we do a lot of printing and mailing as well. After the printing and mailing, what we do is we give it some time and we let the employees respond back to the employer. And because sometimes the addresses are wrong, or maybe someone has been married and they changed their last name, and that needs to be updated on the forms before they're ultimately filed with the IRS. So we're able to include that step as well, just to ensure the highest level of accuracy that we possibly can. So once we have those forms updated once again, we have the final approval for IRS filing. And once we file with the IRS, that's essentially the end of the process for the year. So on to the next slide. So this is just a slide that has to be in here for liability reasons. We are not tax preparers, and nothing that I say should serve as any legal advice. We are not attorneys. We just do ACA reporting. We've done this as long as anyone in the country, which is about 6 years, because you didn't have to do this prior to 2015. So we have a lot of experience. But at the end of the day, we always tell people, hey, if you have an ERISA attorney, you consult with them. And most of the time, they will absolutely validate what we're already saying. But I just have to include this in here that we are not attorneys. So let's just talk about the basics of this stuff. And again, this can be a bit dry, but let's talk through it. Who gets a Form 1095-C? So if you look at who gets a Form 1095C, what it boils down to is it's anyone who was considered full-time for at least 1 month during the applicable reporting year. So if we were looking at 2020 for an applicable reporting year, anyone who was considered full-time for at least 1 month during that year would need to get a Form 1095C, all right? So what constitutes being full-time? Well, that's something we'll have to get into, but I will actually go down into the slide and talk more. So for staffing companies who offer MEC to every employee, which we see pretty regularly, it might be easier to just report for everyone. And we see that a good bit. So what they do is staffing companies will offer MEC to everyone, and they will actually create a form for everyone just to make sure that everyone is included and they don't miss anyone. And so what that does for some employers is it kind of gets them out of the hot water of maybe missing someone who was deemed full-time based on their hours worked during the year. But the thing is sometimes that whole offering MEC and giving everyone a form can become more work, because if you are ever audited, you have to prove that the employee was either not full-time and so they shouldn't receive a form, or the employer shared responsibility penalty for them. Or if you get a late penalty, sometimes it causes the IRS to dig into the details and they go, okay, well, why did this person get a form? Why did this person not get a form? And it's very hard for the employers to substantiate why someone got a form or someone didn't get a form. And so what we recommend and what we do for a lot of clients, and it's really up to the employer's discretion, is we use what's known as a look-back measurement method. The simplest way that I can describe a look-back measurement method is it is a defined period of time that you use to measure the hours of an employee who is considered a variable hour. And the sole purpose for this is to consider or to determine who is actually full-time under the ACA laws. So it's not necessarily for benefits eligibility or anything like that. It's strictly regarding the Affordable Care Act and how the Affordable Care Act defines someone as being full-time or part-time. And this has to do with a threshold of hours that is worked by that employee during this period of time that we call a look-back measurement period. All right. So again, in our opinion, this is totally fine to do as far as, you know, offering MEC to everyone. And a lot of people are able to do that, but it's always safer to use a look back measurement period. So essentially, that's who gets a form, is people who cross a certain threshold of hours worked. And you can use a monthly measurement period where you actually measure the hours of an employee each month, or you can use a look back measurement method. So if we go deeper into the look back measurement method, the look back measurement method provides an alternative to the monthly measurement method, because a lot of times what happens in the monthly measurement method that is difficult for employers is they look back each month and they go, okay, well, employee, let's just say it's Jane Doe. Jane Doe crossed the threshold for hours worked. She should be offered benefits, or should have been offered benefits. So it's like, well, kind of hard to take action on something that's already happened. Whereas if you have a look back measurement period, say that it's a 10-month look back measurement period, you will be measuring those hours over that 10-month period. You'll then have an administrative period that allows you to determine who was eligible for benefits based on the hours worked, and you're actually able to enroll the people in that. And then you have what's known as a stability period going forward, in which you must offer benefits to that employee as a full-time employee, regardless of the hours they are currently working. So under the look-back measurement period, as I have mentioned, the employers will test whether an employee averages 30 hours of service per week during a measurement period. Just making sure that I can see here. I want to make sure I cover everything that needs to be covered on this slide. So there are different circumstances that an employer can use. They can use different measurement methods, and it's determined on some of the variables that are offered on the bottom of this slide very specifically, but I don't want to tarry too much on this. What you need to know about the look-back measurement method is that essentially it is the preferred method for measuring the hours worked by variable hour employees. It is what typically the IRS will be looking for. They want to see, okay, did you measure this employee's hours for a period of time before you determined that they were full-time and should be offered benefits? And so what it does is it actually gives you the ability to create a paper trail and memorialize the process that you used for determining full-time and part-time status. So again, this is at the employer's discretion on what type of measurement period they want to use. There's a number of combinations that the measurement period could be. So you could use like a 6 month look back and a 6 month stability, but what we see most commonly is a 10 month look back. So here's, and this slide just serves to outline why the 10 month look back and 10 month stability period works so well for staffing companies in general. So when employees are ongoing, in other words, they've been with you longer than a year, you'll end up counting their hours over a period that is set. That is what we call the look back measurement method. And so you'll use a standard measurement and a standard look back period. And then you can take up to 90 days as an administrative period. This is where you actually offer benefits and enroll individuals in those benefits, which is health insurance. All right, so what happens typically, what we see, is that people will use a 10-month look-back period. Then they'll use a 2-month administrative period to be able to actually enroll these individuals. And then they'll use a 10-month stability period where they will have to make sure that those same individuals are offered appropriate coverage as a full-time employee. And so here's the thing, there's a little sub-note at the bottom of this text or this slide, and it says, generally staffing companies either don't count hours because they offer minimum essential coverage to everyone, like date of hire, or they will use a look-back method. However, it does make sense to get advice on your particular situation. So that's essentially the look back measurement method. And now we're going to look at the next period of the look back measurement, and that is the administrative period. And it's really important to note here that the administrative period is not necessarily an employer requirement, but it is something that employers find very useful as far as being able to actually enroll people in the coverages that they need. All right, so the big thing to note here, the most salient point, is that the company can't have a gap of more than 90 days between their look back period, right, and when they start. So from when they start measuring, they have a look back period where they measure hours, and then there's an administrative period, and then they actually have to offer those benefits. That period cannot be more than 90 days, all right? And so it needs to be done in less than 90 days. And just to have a safe window, a lot of people do it in 2 months. And so what they'll do is they'll say, okay, here's a 10-month look back, and here's the 2-month administrative period, and that gives them time to kind of get their ducks in a row, make sure the appropriate employees are offered the coverages that they needed. With our software, what we do is ongoing, we take a payroll file, there's hours worked in that payroll file, and what we're able to do is we're able to say, okay, look, these are the individuals who are trending to become eligible. These are the individuals who have already become eligible who need to be offered coverage by this date. And essentially, we're able to lay out for you these are the groups of employees that need to enter into administrative period. That administrative period cannot last longer than this, and the coverage needs to be offered to them from this date until this date. And again, the most common one that we see is 10-month look back, 2-month administrative period, 10-month stability period. Another question that we get a lot is, does the indemnity policy count towards ACA? A lot of staffing companies implement an indemnity policy. The answer is no. Unfortunately, it is not considered MEC for ACA purposes, and so it doesn't protect against the A or the B penalties. So they don't provide the same sort of coverage provided by a major medical health insurance plan, and they don't meet the coverage requirements of the Affordable Care Act, which is really the point of the 1095C reporting. The point of the 1095C reporting is simply this. The IRS has to know if an employer was compliant with their benefits offerings, and the only way they know that is if the information on the 1095C is submitted to them. They're then able to essentially compare that with W-2s and see if the coverage was affordable. They're able to see, you know, who was in a limited non-assessment period for what period of time. There's a number of different data points that can be extrapolated from those 1095C forms that the IRS uses. And a good bit of it's complicated, and a lot of people who try to do this in-house find that it is very difficult to do. So then we get down to something that is very interesting within the staffing industry, employee start date and term date. And so this is a common requirement for ACA reporting vendors looking to capture employee employment periods. So just to go over this slide, generally speaking, the start date is the first day in which a new hire works an hour of service. So if they work a full hour of service, we now have a start date. All right. And the termination date is the last day that they work an hour of service, and that hour of service is obviously paid. So this can be a little bit tricky for staffing companies because they may not officially terminate someone. So someone may be on assignment or off assignment, but they're not necessarily terminated in the payroll. So the system will show them maybe as still being hired. However, they're not working actual hours. And so we have to measure it a little bit differently than some systems do. So the easiest thing, and again, this doesn't apply to every single employer because there's a lot of dynamics that go into this, is to consider the employees who don't work an hour of service and are not on family medical leave for 13 weeks in a row to be new hires for ACA purposes. So let me say that a different way. If there's a 13-week gap where there are no billable hours, what the easiest thing to do is consider that person who had a 13-week gap in service a new hire when they come back for ACA purposes. And so once they return, they will have a new start date, and that will begin the minute that they begin their new assignment, assuming they had been out for 13 weeks. And if they're gone for fewer than 13 weeks, so they're on assignment and they had no billable hours, but at the same time, there was the period of time where they weren't working was less than 13 weeks, you would not count them as ever having left, and they wouldn't have a new start date. Their start date would just be a continuation of their previous start date, and that would continue on until they reached a term date where they were terminated or the end of the reporting year hits. So that is how start date and term dates are determined, and maybe by now you can see why this can be difficult for people who are in the staffing industry. So let's talk about some penalties. This is the cost associated with non-compliance. So the IRS is actively enforcing penalties, and they are a bit delayed on these penalties. So they've already done 2016 penalties. 2015 penalties weren't as bad because there was some leniency given to large employers in 2015. The 2016 has been implemented, 2017 has been implemented, and now they are starting on 2018. COVID postponed some of these penalty letters by a little bit, but now they are picking back up. So typically it's about a two-year delay. So it will be around 2022 before we see penalties associated with 2020 if everything stays status quo like they've been doing for the last 5 or 6 years. All right, so the reporting penalties are based on your number of forms filed. And if there's no forms that were filed, it's based on your number of W-2s. Again, this is one of the downfalls of giving everyone a form because they were offered NEC on the first day. If something was done incorrectly or found to be unaffordable, the IRS is going to look at all the forms first, and they're going to use the form count as the basis for penalty assessment. So in our opinion, being able to use a look-back measurement method to determine who is actually full-time and should get a form is another way to just kind of keep yourself more compliant and out of hot water. So not that you would be doing anything wrong, it's just you have to answer these questions in the event that the IRS comes knocking. So they're now charging 2 times more for each form of failure to send to the IRS and failure to send to the employee for companies who do not file. So in other words, the penalties have increased over time because there's two sets of penalties when it comes to forms. If you do not furnish the form on time to the employees or you do not furnish the form on time to the IRS, there are penalties associated with each one. So here are the 2020 reporting penalties, and these penalties will adjust for inflation as time goes forward. So if you file forms late, but they're 30 days within the deadline, it's $50 per return, and there's a maximum fine of about $550,000. If you file them, and remember the date is March 31st, but if you file them between 31 days late and August 1st, that price jumps to, or I should say penalty, jumps to $110 per return, and the max there is about $1.6 million. After August 1st, if you do not file, it is $270 per return with a max of $3.3 million. If it is found that the company has intentionally disregarded even creating these forms or trying to create these forms, it's $550 per return, and there is no limitation on that penalty. And if you do not furnish the forms to employees, so in other words, you create 1095C forms, but you do not distribute them to the workforce, you do not give them to the employees themselves, that carries a penalty of $270 per return. So the thing is, one of the scariest things about this, and it's mentioned on the bottom of this slide, is that intentional disregard is pretty frightening because there is no limitation. So no matter what you do, don't fall into that category, all right? Even if you attempt to do this yourself, do it, file it. That is not our recommendation. We would prefer that you use a vendor like us to do it for you, who has experience and a track record of successfully pulling this off each year. But no matter what, don't let yourself fall into that intentional disregard category. All right, so businesses, the penalties for non-compliance can change based on the gross receipts or the size of businesses. So we have these small business penalties that are outlined. I'm not going to read every single one of these penalties on this screen, but there are certain penalties associated with businesses that have gross receipts under $5 million. And those actually are a little bit different than the previous penalties that I mentioned. All right, so the next thing, again, I'm trying to get all of this out so that I can leave time for questions at the end of the presentation. So we have questions related to the 91st day of coverage rule. Why must you have your full-time employees covered by the 91st day? So here's the thing. If a new hire begins a position that is expected to be full-time based on how the position has worked in the past, and that could be also attributed to the job listing or the company's good faith estimation. Essentially, when you hire someone, do you think that they are going to be full-time? That person should be offered coverage by their 91st day of employment. And technically, the coverage must be offered by the first day of the fourth full month that they are working to avoid the ESRP penalty. So, all right, again, this stuff gets granular and it can be very confusing. What's up with the 91st day? Because the rule says that the coverage must be offered by the first day of the fourth full month that they are working. So if you have three months and some of those months have 31 days in them, you can actually go over 90 days. But see, your limited non-assessment period is not to be more than 90 days. So the point is you need to have that coverage in place before the 91st day just to keep yourself safe. All right. I'm just going to go ahead and go through this because that's pretty much the summation. We have a number of questions that are asked, and a lot of those questions are employer specific. And so we just did our best here in this presentation to cover some of the frequently asked questions as they pertain to staffing agencies. One of the broad things that we get a lot of is what's going to happen with ACA reporting. Previously, and we've been having this conversation from day one, we've taken the stance that subsidized health care is not going to go away. No matter what administration there is, who's in office, they may change the name of it, but as long as there's a health care exchange, as long as individuals are getting subsidies for their health insurance, the government is going to have to track who was eligible for what subsidy And in order to know who was eligible, they'll always have to know what the employers offered and didn't offer. So even if the requirement for employers to offer certain types of health coverage went away, the IRS was still going to have to know what the employer offered in order to balance that with the fact that an employee went to the subsidy and received, an employer went to the exchange and received a subsidy. But now we're in this situation where we have someone who is very pro-ACA taking office. And so essentially, what can we expect in the next few years? There's a little write-up here. I'm just going to go on a little tangent as far as what my opinion is. Everything that we're seeing is that the Affordable Care Act, the intention of the current administration is to expand the Affordable Care Act. Many of you may know that there is a lawsuit that has gone to the Supreme Court. It originated in Texas. It went to, I think, the Fifth Circuit. It was elevated to the Supreme Court. And the Supreme Court has already heard oral arguments. And some people were thinking that the Supreme Court may overturn the ACA. That seems not very likely to happen. If it happens, it would happen in next year, and so there would still be another year of reporting. But the justices have essentially already come out and said this is not likely to happen. So we are not thinking that the ACA will be overturned anytime soon. With recent developments between the House and the Senate and Democratic majorities, we are thinking that the Affordable Care Act is only going to be expanded going forward. And so that's essentially where our opinion lies right now. And so we must do whatever we can to stay as compliant with these healthcare laws as we can. And the important thing to note is that we are here to help. We're here to help with questions, but more importantly than the questions, we're here to help you do this, and in many cases, do it for you. And so we're reputable. We have a very good track record of being able to do this, and we're able to do it very effectively, very efficiently. And I do believe that we will be doing this for some time to come, and it makes me very happy that we will be available to help you with your compliance reporting needs as well. So with that, I will say I will close my mouth and stop talking so much. And I just want to say thank you for listening thus far, and we are ready to take some questions. So fire away.
Great. So go ahead and submit any questions that you have using the chat or the Q&A feature, so that we can, address anything for you here today. And as we're kind of waiting for people to put in their questions or their messages, what's the first thing that you would recommend a staffing company to do to take this step into, filing these forms, looking for a provider? What are your key takeaways that they should investigate?
Yeah, so I would like Amanda Brock, if you want to answer some of these questions. Amanda Brock is in the trenches every single day, so I have opinions, but I also want to give her a chance to talk and then maybe kind of break up some of the monotony of just hearing my voice the whole time. Amanda, are you available on the phone?
I am.
Awesome. So in your opinion, Amanda, what do you think one of the first steps that a staffing agency would want to take if they're interested in moving forward?
If the staffing group is interested in moving forward, one, to get a full grasp of how many employees they are guessing they will need to report, because that's going to be the first question that anyone here at ACA Reporting, staff ACA reporting, will ask: how many employees do you have? Of course, it's going to be, a guessing game with staffing groups, because either they will want to report everyone with that MEC-only coverage, or they will want to report anyone if they've done a true look-back method that they've been doing in the past that could have been made an offer that was MEC and minimum value. So that's the first step, really. It's kind of determining how many employees that they're going to want to report for that given year, and then contacting a vendor like ourselves that can help them walk through the steps of getting the forms the most accurate that we can.
And when would you suggest that someone get something like this in place, knowing, you know, the deadlines that are set from year to year?
The earlier the better. Obviously, we're not going to be able to get a full range of data until after January 1st for any calendar year. But the sooner they start the process where we can get on a telephone call with the group to determine what type of benefits, determine what type of data they will need to send to us, the better. If we were moving from this point on, I would say as soon as possible. The deadline this year for forms for any group is to have them postmarked by the 2nd of March. So we do have a bit of time, but the sooner they can get the ball rolling, the better.
Perfect. And we do have a question regarding, can you discuss how you price your services, or is that something that they would be able to have a one-on-one call with you to go through their specifics?
Absolutely. I can actually talk about it. We do have pricing that is live online, and TRICOM has a coupon code that for any group that is interested and uses TRICOM, they can get that coupon code, go to the ACA reporting site. How we do our packages, if you have an aggregated group, so a group with more than one EIN that files taxes together, you have two different packages that you can choose from. And all of our packages include the creation of the forms. We give the forms in PDF form to the client. We file to the IRS, and we give the client the results from the IRS, and we decode that acknowledgement file. So if there's any 10 errors, those taxpayer identification number errors, which is names and socials not matching up, if there's any of those, we decode that message for the client and give them the results of their packages or of their filings, excuse me. But so we have three levels. If you're aggregated, you can only choose between the top two tiers because the top two tiers have account managers that are associated with the packages. They have a person one-on-one that they can speak with. The lowest tier is self-service. I kind of equate it to a TurboTax. For lack of better terminology, you get the software, you work through that software as a client. We do have a support line and a support email that you can call into, but you don't have a direct person that you're talking to each time. It's kind of like round robin in our office. All the account managers maintain those support lines. The second package level is enhanced. In an enhanced package, you're going to get that ACA account manager that helps you go through the process. They're your one-on-one contact, but you as the client are still responsible to put your data into our template, which can be a little bit difficult for staffing groups just because we do have to have a full-time or part-time designation for each person, excuse me, on the template. And then the top tier is true full service. Most of our staffing groups honestly use this true full service level. You get the account manager. We generate the forms just like any other. We file to the IRS. We give you the results. But the biggest change between enhanced and true full service is who does the data. With the true full service package, you send us your data, your raw data from your payroll provider and from your medical provider, and we modify everything, put it in our template, upload it to the, excuse me, everyone, to the ACA dashboard, and then the first time clients really have a big hands-on is just reviewing their forms.
Great. Another question that has come in is they offer the MEC to every employee that they onboard and also use the look back. They've been doing, we have been going on 1560 hours to offer the MV plan. Is that correct?
Say that last part with the 60 hours.
So they've been going on a 1,560 hours to offer the MV plan.
So a yearly look back, because that's the amount of hours for a full-time person for a year. That's perfect, actually. And I have a lot of staffing groups that do that, that they will offer MEC date of hire and then only offer that MEC minimum value completely compliant policy for anyone who has done their look back and have been deemed eligible for the next however long, you know, for their stability period. So that's absolutely perfect way of handling your benefits with a staffing flexible hour type group.
And in that scenario, are you saying that the reporting is only on the employees that met that second tier?
That's when it would be up to the client. I have had clients go both ways. I have a group right now that does the MEC only policy, and then they also have the MEC minimum value after their yearly look back. We report, obviously, we make sure we report the people that is on that yearly look back. And then anyone who actually took the MEC only policy, we will indicate them as being a full-time employee only because they did take the medical coverage that was offered to them, but they don't actually indicate people as being full-time in our software until they've been deemed eligible for that MEC minimum value policy. However, we do have groups who want to, you know, cover all their bases and say, hey, we made that MEC only offer. I want everyone to have a form so it covers my own backside, you know, when it comes to the IRS. So just make sure you distinguish between who was MEC only and who actually were eligible for the MEC minimum value. So it really just depends on what that particular client wants to do.
Okay. Another question, why are you possibly fined for offering the MEC to a temp that didn't actually make full time?
That's a good question. And you have the ability, so what that plays down to is honestly, if a group was to get a penalty, and you could prove that, hey, I made an offer of MEC only, because a MEC only policy is not completely compliant with the ACA standards. You did make an offer to a part-time employee that was MEC only. You can prove that they did not have the hours, but this is going to be for the person who's actually doing a very good job at tracking their employees' hours with like a look back method. You can go back to your data. Say you're doing a year look back with a year stability period. This person was part-time at this point in time when they could have taken a subsidy. This is why I did not offer them the MEC minimum value. They chose to decline the MEC only policy. So it's really kind of responding to any type of kickback you would get from the IRS.
Yeah, another thing I would add to that. Oh, sorry, Amanda.
No, go ahead, Trent.
Another thing I would add to that is, again, what Amanda's dead on, you would have to substantiate that person was actually part-time, and you'd need to prove that. But a lot of the MEC plans that are offered within the staffing industry are actually self-funded plans. And if they actually – if you don't offer it to a part-time employee – not a big deal because they're part-time, but if that person actually enrolled in MEC coverage, I just wanted to point this out, if that person enrolled in a self-funded MEC plan, that person would have to get a form because they're on self-funded coverage instead of like a fully insured health plan. And on a self-funded coverage, there's no carrier to report information back to the IRS, so essentially the employer serves as the carrier in that situation. It's just a little caveat I wanted to add. Go ahead, Amanda.
That's good. I would say, you know, you're making an offer to someone who's not really deemed eligible with a population that it's hard to narrow down when someone does or does not get an offer of being full-time. I think with staffing agencies, the best thing you can do is set up a very good look back measurement. You can do the monthly measurement, but from what I've seen, doing a look back, setting that out is your best way. And as long as you can prove to the IRS that you've done your part, you're good to go.
So when using a service provider such as yours, you know, when the IRS has questions, who do they go back to? Do you field that, or does the client, the staffing company, field that?
It always goes back to the client. When it comes to the ACA, the way the ACA was created, none of the responsibility goes back to the vendor. It always stays with the client. But say the client does get a letter stating that so-and-so took a subsidy and they're trying to figure out why an offer wasn't made, we can help the client look into and give them information to respond to the IRS. We can't respond on their behalf, but we can give them the verbiage and the information they need to respond to the IRS.
Okay. Another question is, by self-funded, they deduct the temp pay, then pay the MEC bill per month, per week. Is that correct?
Trent, do you know that one?
Would you mind asking that question one more time?
Sure. And I think this is regarding the self-funded that you were mentioning before for MEC plans. It says, so mm-hmm. with the self-funded, they deduct from the temp pay, and then they pay their MEC bill per month slash week.
Okay. What's the question?
Is that right? I guess, is that correct? And then they come back and say, this is how we do it. We deduct from the temp, and then the staffing agency pay the bill.
Are they asking if the policy is self-funded by that description?
Yeah, maybe just want to cover the difference on self-funded.
Yeah, so essentially the best way that I can – so it comes down to who's paying the premium. Is the employer – or here we go. Who's paying the claims? That's what I should say. Is the employer responsible for the claims load, or is there an actual insurance carrier who is paying those claims on their behalf? The MEC plan that's offered by Essential Staff Care is self-funded. That clears up about – because a lot of people use Essential Staff Care for their MEC coverage, and
right.
That is actually a self-funded plan. That's a self-funded plan. That blanket right there covers a lot of people who are implementing the MEC plan. I would have to get into the benefit details to actually look to say, hey, this is definitely a self-funded plan.
Mm-hmm.
I won't be able to determine that just from that question, and I apologize for not being able to do so.
No, that's okay. I think that definitely helps. And again, for the ones that asked the question, feel free to reach out to staff ACA Direct. They can go through specific questions related to your business and make sure you get the answers that you're looking for. I do have another question that came in. It says, our MEC plan is self-funded and the employee pays the insurance company monthly.
Okay. Well, what's the question?
So it sounds to me like this is, again, just – it sounds like there's some questions regarding the self-funded. So I think, as you mentioned earlier, self-funded really means that those claims, the insurance claims, are paid by the staffing company rather than the insurance company, and that's what makes it self-funded?
Yes.
Is that
– Yes. And so
okay.
I think what you said applies universally across the board. Each individual employer will have their own circumstances and their own way of doing things. What I would encourage people to do is reach out to us, and that will let us ask some follow-up questions to kind of gauge where the employer is with their benefit offerings, and we'll be able to answer those questions a lot more accurately that way. But these are certainly things that come up regularly, but they warrant more information.
Absolutely. Okay, so you know we're getting close to the end here. We've had a lot of really great questions and discussion. A lot of information was covered today, and I know that there is so much more to it, particularly once you start getting into this as it relates to your company business. So, again, happy to take some of those questions offline. And Amanda and Trent, thank you so much for taking the time out of your day to cover this important topic, very relevant to the timeline that, you know, they have right now for meeting this ACA reporting. Do you have any final things you'd like to share before we wrap up today's session?
Yeah, I think I just want to clarify one point because I was covering things with a sense of generality on the slides, but as it pertains to this year, Amanda, do you want to go over Amanda Brock, do you want to go over the deadlines for this year because there has been an extension in the event that someone is listening? I don't want them to think, oh, they've already missed it. Can you cover that for them and just talk about what time they have left for this year if they're looking at 2020 reporting?
Absolutely. For forms to be generated and postmarked to employees or handed to employees if they're in an internal office, that deadline is March the 2nd. If you have any California employees, California has been a little stickler this year. Because there is an individual mandate in California, a statewide mandate, forms had to be postmarked to employees by the 31st of January. I know you hear that and start panicking because that is Sunday. However, we did get notification this week, and late's never better, that they will not penalize any California companies that send out forms after the 31st because they were not able to change their deadline to correspond with the IRS's extension. They're not charging anything, but you do still need to actually file state things, which I will cover in just a second very quickly. And then the deadline to file to the IRS is March 31st. To mention briefly, there are states that have individual mandates that require a company to file to these individual state online portals, California, Massachusetts, Rhode Island, New Jersey, Washington, D.C., and Vermont. You do not have to do anything this year. They've waived reporting for this year, but the other five, there are responsibilities on the employers to file to these individual state online portals. So that is something to think about as well. And the deadline for that filing is March 31st, just like the IRS. So there is time for that.
Thank you so much for covering that. And again, if anyone has any additional questions, you can reach out to me directly. I'm happy to share the contact information with you. You'll also find them on TRICOM's website. And we'll put a recording of this session on our website for anyone who may want to share it with others or listen to it again. So with that, we'll close out today's presentation. And I thank you so much for joining us. And look forward to seeing you in our next webinar session.
Thank you.
Have a great day.